Hello everyone, welcome to my YouTube channel Simplifying UPSC with Ease with me Arpita Sharma, and today we are going to start with two important topics, that is President and Vice President. Before moving forward, this is my referral code Sharma20. Using this you can get 10% discount on any of the courses on Unacademy Plus. So today let's start with the President topic. When we talk about President, which articles are present in the Indian Constitution which deal with the Union Executive? Let us understand that. So the Article 52 278 of the Indian Constitution, present in Part 5 of the Indian Constitution, they deal with these articles deal with the Union Executive. Okay, these are the various articles from 52 to 78. Total 20 approx articles are present in Part 5 which deal with the Union Executive. Now the question comes, what is present in Union Executive? In Union Executive, the Attorney General is covered, the President is covered, President is also a part of Union Executive, the Vice President is also a part of Union Executive, the Prime Minister is also a part of Union Executive, and the Council of Ministers is also a part of Union Executive. Now when we talk about the President, he is known as the head of the Indian state and he is also the first citizen of India. He acts as a symbol of unity, integrity and solidarity of the nation. So he is a very, very important part of a country, right? Underline this. He is a very important part of a country. So when we talk about the election of the President, the President is elected not directly by the people, unlike in the Lok Sabha elections. In Lok Sabha elections, direct people involvement is present, right? But in the election of President, directly people do not vote. President is elected by members of the Electoral College. Now you must be asking, you must be thinking, what is this Electoral College? Electoral College is a college, is a, you know, association where the elected members of both of the houses of parliament are present. The elected members of Legislative Assembly of States are present, and elected members of Legislative Assembly of Union Territories of Delhi and Puducherry are present. Now what about the other Union Territories? The other Union Territories have population so small that representation is not necessary. Now number of votes which each elected member of Legislative Assembly of each state and parliament is entitled to cast at such election, such presidential election, shall be determined in these two following manners. First manner is value of the vote of an MLA. How it is to be counted? Total population of state, state ki total population divided by total number of elected members in the State Legislative Assembly. SLA mein jitne bhi total number of elected members hain, usse divide karenge into 1/100. That will give you the value of the vote of an MLA. And value of the vote of an MP, how it is to be determined or calculated? Total value of votes of all MLAs of a state, ek state ke sare MLAs ka jo vote hai, unki value divided by total number of elected members of parliament, MP ke jitne bhi total elected members hai, unse divide kar denge. It will give you the value of the vote of an MP. Now the President's election is held in accordance with the system of proportional representation, wherein the vote is counted or vote is casted by single transferable vote and voting is by secret ballot. Now candidate, in order to be declared elected, agar koi candidate elections, presidential elections ke liye khada ho raha hai aur usse elect hona hai to the office of President, then he or she must secure a fixed quota of votes. How the quota, electoral quota is calculated? Total number of valid votes polled divided by 1 + 1, that is equal to 2 + 1. This is how the electoral quota is calculated. The election of a person as a President cannot be challenged, underline cannot be challenged, on the grounds that Electoral College was incomplete. Koi ye nahi bol sakta ki Electoral College ye jo members the wo present hi nahi the, isliye jo President ke taur par koi insaan elect hua hai to wo election incomplete hai ya valid nahi hai, aisa nahi bola ja sakta. Now the another important fact is that if election of a President, of a person as a President, is declared void by none other than the Supreme Court, then the acts, the work done by this President before such declaration are not considered as invalid. Okay, maan lo, for example, today the Supreme Court says that this President's election is void. Now he is no longer the president. Then all the acts done by this president before such declaration will continue to remain in force. They will be valid. Okay, they will not be considered as void. Now there are different reasons given by the constitution makers which chose the indirect election of the president due to various reasons. So there were various reasons why the constitution makers said that there should be indirect election for the post of president. First reason was that the president is just the nominal head or the nominal executive. Right? Real powers are given to Council of Ministers, which is headed by the Prime Minister. So the president should be elected through indirect election only. Right? Second, direct election is very costly, as you all know. Right? And it is very time and energy consuming process also. Right? That is why also, to make the process very easy and simplified, the president is elected through indirect election. Now, there are certain qualifications which a person must possess in order to be eligible for the election of the president. First, he or she should be a citizen of India. That is a must. If you are not a citizen of India, how can you be qualified to stand for the presidential elections? Second, he or she should have completed 35 years of age. Underline this. He or she should be qualified for election as a member of Lok Sabha. Then only he or she will be eligible for to stand as the in the presidential elections. And he or she should not hold any office of profit under union government, state government or any local authority or any other public authority. Right? Now the question comes, what is this office of profit? So this office of profit, it is a position. This is very important. It's a position in the government which cannot be held by an MLA or an MP. Why I am writing an when it's M over here? Because the pronunciation, you know, is of A, MP, right? That is why I am using an. Now the post of office of profit can yield salaries apart from what he or she is getting as a president or MLA or MP, perks and other benefits. So apart from your own salary and your own perks which you are getting through your position, you are also yielding salaries and perks through other offices. That is known as office of profit. That position is known as office of profit. And this office of profit term, when did it originate in India? The origin of this term can be found in the English Act of Settlement in the year 1701. Under this law, no person who has an office or place of profit under the king or receives a pension from the crown shall be capable of serving as a member of the House of Commons. मतलब दो जगह से आप पैसे नहीं ले सकते हो, दो जगह से आप salaries, perks वगैरह नहीं ले सकते हो. एक position पर हो, वहीं से salaries और perks आपको मिलेंगी. Now further, the nomination of a candidate for election to the office of president must be subscribed by at least 50 electors. There should be 50 electors as proposers. These electors will be featuring as the proposers, and 50 electors as seconders. That is those people who will second this particular proposal. Okay, so 50 people should keep forward the proposal of standing as the candidate, and 50 should be their supporters. Okay, now every candidate has to make a security deposit of rupees 15,000 in the RBI. Right, so underline, with the RBI the security deposit will be submitted. All right, then this security deposit, this 15,000 rupees in the RBI are liable to be forfeited in case the candidate fails to secure, to gather 1/6 of the votes polled. Then this 15,000 will be given back to him. So this was the part 1 of the chapter president. In the part 2, we are going to study the term, the impeachment and the vacancy of president, the powers and functions of the president. Okay, absolute veto, emergency powers, military powers, financial powers, pocket veto, suspensive veto. What are all these? We are going to discuss in part 2.